I decided today, for this month, to continue the topic that we covered last month, and that was on mental prayer. And you remember when I read the section from a rule, our confraternity rule, that says that all the members, in addition to your other prayers, the daily rosary, your spiritual reading, the little office of the Immaculate Conception, that we spend 10 minutes every morning in a morning of meditation. And that is a very difficult thing for many people to do. In fact, many people just think of prayer only as vocal prayer. But you all know that there are the two kinds of prayer, vocal prayer and mental prayer, and we combine them in the rosary when we meditate on the mysteries. But I would like to share, so we talked about mental prayer last month, and I would like to share a few reflections from a wonderful book I have been reading, and it's called The Nature and Methods of Mental Prayer by Right Reverend Monsignor Charles Hugo Doyle. And so this is it's a very good book on mental prayer that is simple. In other words, he brings it down to the level that everyone can understand. So he talks about what is mental prayer, gives the definition, and it goes through the definition, that it is communicating to God, well, first of all, reflecting on a truth of our faith, and then allowing our heart to get involved and to make acts of love, of adoration, of thanksgiving, of petition, of admiration, and et cetera, zeal, and so forth. Here's a quote from St. Ignatius of Loyola. Mental prayer is the shortest road to perfection. He who makes progress in mental prayer makes similar progress in perfection. It is in the time of mental prayer that the soul is replenished with holy thoughts, devout aspirations and desires, good resolutions, and the most fervent love of God. It is then she lays on the altar of sacrifice all her passions, all her sinful thoughts, her lingering attachments to the world, and all that flatters self-love. Now, when we speak of mental prayer, there are two kinds of mental prayer, you might say, two different aspects. One is meditation, sometimes referred to as discursive meditation, and that is more thinking about the truths of our faith and letting them really penetrate. And then the other is the affections, the prayers, the thoughts of our heart that we address to Almighty God. And remember, last month I was mentioning how St. Francis de Sales speaks of these two kinds of mental prayer, and he says that the meditation is like a needle, and then the mental prayer is like a thread. And you need the needle to sew a garment, but it's the thread that holds it together and it stays there. And so the thread is more valuable, but the needle is necessary. Well, what is the needle? It's meditating on the mystery of our faith. So let's say you pick up a book, An Imitation of Christ or whatever, and you read the meditation on death. And then you think about death. You think about the shortness of life. You think about the length of eternity. You think about the fact that God can call us at any time out of this world. And when you think about it deeply in prayer, those truths sink in. They sink into our soul. They become a part of us. And the author here asks the question, why are there so many Catholics who are not practicing their faith or not practicing with fervor? And he answers, it's not because they do not believe in the truths of faith, but they don't think about them, or don't think about them enough. Now listen to these words from the book of Deuteronomy in the Old Testament. And this is the book, Deuteronomy, in which God summarizes everything that he had taught Moses, the Ten Commandments and all the other laws and obligations of the Jewish people. And he summarizes them, and then he says this, these words, which I command thee this day, shall be in thy heart, and thou shalt tell them to thy children, and thou shalt meditate upon them, sitting in thy house, and walking on thy journey, sleeping and rising. In other words, these truths of faith should be so deeply impressed upon us that we think about them all the time. They become part of our life, part of our thoughts. He goes on to quote again the book of Deuteronomy, another chapter, lay up these my words in your heart and hearts and minds, and hang them for a sign on your hands, and place them between your eyes. Teach your children that they meditate on them when thou sittest in thy house, and when thou walkest on thy way, and when thou liest down, and when thou risest up. Pretty much the same words. But this is the idea, to think about these truths of our faith and really let that thought, that reflection, penetrate deeply. So to make a good meditation, it helps to have a good book. Start with a good book that you read. I mentioned The Imitation of Christ, which is so excellent, but there are many other books you can use. And then you read a section and you think about that. But then that thought leads on to the prayer of the heart. I want to give you a couple more quotations from this book. This is St. Alphonsus Liguori. It is morally impossible for a religious who is not a lover of mental prayer to be a good religious. If you see a tepid religious, say he does not make mental prayer, and you shall say the truth. The devil works hard to make religious lose the love of meditation, and should he conquer them in this, he will gain them all. So, applying that to the religious life, the value. Here's another quote from St. Alphonsus along the same lines. As long as a religious gives himself to mental prayer, you will behold him a model of modesty, of humility, of devotion, of mortification. Let him abandon mental prayer, and soon the modesty of his looks disappears, his pride will burst forth at the least word of offense. He will scarcely think any longer of mortifying himself. On the contrary, he will be in love with vanities, amusements, and earthly pleasures. Why? The water of grace flows into his soul no longer. He wants life. He has abandoned mental prayer. The garden is parched, and the evil grows daily worse. So he has a lot of other quotes in here. There's one other one I wanted to give you if I can find it, on just the value in general of mental prayer. I can't find it right now, but I'll give you a couple of quotes of St. Teresa of Avila. She says, whoever he be who has not commenced the exercise of mental prayer, I beseech him, for the love of our Lord, not to deprive himself of so great a benefit. Here we have nothing to fear, but much to hope. And though we should not advance much, or strive to be so perfect as to deserve those favors and caresses which God gives to perfect souls, yet at least one advances along the path which leads to heaven, and knows it is the right way. I am convinced that no one, by the divine mercy, ever made choice of God for a friend whom he did not well repay, if he persevered in his friendly communication. For mental prayer is nothing else but a treaty of friendship with our Lord, and often speaking alone with him whom we know loves us. One more quote, St. Teresa of Avila again. I hold for certain that the Lord will conduct to the haven of salvation the soul that perseveres in mental prayer, in spite of all the sins which the devil may propose. So mental prayer, all of the saints speak about this, is so powerful. So we ask you in your rule, your daily prayer routine, to make a 10-minute meditation in the morning. And that is something, if you haven't been doing, to really work on. And find a good book. There are, you know, various books. I could recommend some different meditation books, but you could just use The Imitation of Christ. And use a short section, and you first of all clear your mind. And then you slowly read the section. You reflect upon it. You think about its meaning. You let it sink in. So to speak, you digest it. You really make it a part of you. And then that leads to the thoughts, the prayers, the petitions, the affections, as they're called, that are really the fruit of mental prayer. But the meditation is the thinking on these truths of our faith. And is not this the problem with so many Catholics? They don't think enough. They don't think deeply enough about what we believe. Because if we all did, we certainly would become great saints. And mental prayer is a great means of accomplishing that. Let us be resolved to stick with it, even if you find it difficult, to persevere in that practice every morning, part of your morning prayers, first thing in the day.